This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Chapter 1. Beginning the Journey. Relying on God has to begin all over again every day, as if nothing yet had been done. C.S. Lewis' Letters to Malcolm, chiefly on prayer. It was a sunny January day, and we were heading to the doctor for Bob's appointment. Just an ordinary appointment, nothing to worry about. Sure, he had been acting a little off lately, a bit forgetful, asking the same questions over and over, unable to remember names or dates. But everyone has those problems, don't they? He was a bit depressed, the world had changed, and his skills weren't in demand anymore. He was worried about his favorite aunt because she was old and not doing well. He was just trying to find himself. Or at least that's what I told myself. I was upbeat. I was planning to retire in 6 months, and we were going to do all the things we just hadn't had time to do, spend more time with our grandchildren, take long beach walks in our beloved Maine coast, perhaps sell our home to begin condo living. I would read those books that had been piling up and have rich conversations with Bob and friends over leisurely cups of coffee. Yes, life held such promise. Nothing would go wrong. I had lived a happy life. For 24 years, I served as pastor of Women for Grace Chapel, a large and vibrant church in the heart of historic Lexington, Massachusetts. My career had given me the unexpected opportunity to become a world traveler. If there was an opportunity to go, I did, with Bob's full support and encouragement. And I went without a care, because he was so capable. We tend to accept our happy lives and think they'll always be that way. Bob had been retired for a few years and was adjusting well. He enjoyed puttering around in the yard and chatting with the neighbors or with anyone who happened to walk by. His career in the environmental field had taken him around the country as he offered consultation in this cutting-edge industry. When not traveling, he taught classes at church to adults who were exploring faith, and his non-judgmental and light-hearted manner drew many closer to the Lord. He also served for many years as an elder, and his endearing ways made him approachable to all. But then, there was the forgetfulness. Changes. I'm going to say three things, the doctor told Bob. Red. Sunshine. New York. They went on chatting for a short time. I repeated those three words over and over in my mind. Okay, Bob, the doctor asked, what were those three words I told you a few minutes ago? I was ready with the answer. But when I glanced at Bob, I saw him looking blankly, first at the doctor and then at me. Our son brought it up first. I was not totally surprised, but a bit stunned. It was one of those things when you really only see the signs in retrospect, as if through a rearview mirror. Because my husband was so high-functioning, the diagnosis was a gradual unfolding, a very long dusk before impending, though certain darkness. Aura. After an awkward moment, the doctor moved on to some other cognitive tests. Bob failed each one. It appears to be a classic case of Alzheimer's disease. I heard the doctor's words, but they seemed to be echoing from a deep tunnel. Bob seemingly heard nothing, still displaying his warm, engaging smile. God's mercy, I thought. Alzheimer's disease is an ugly, tragic disease. At this point, there is no cure. Best estimates are that a new case of Alzheimer's is diagnosed in America about every 70 seconds. It is not a normal part of aging. Alzheimer's disease, AD, is a progressive, degenerative disorder that attacks the brain's nerve cells or neurons, resulting in loss of memory, thinking and language skills, and behavioral changes. AD is the most common cause of dementia or loss of intellectual function among people aged 65 and older. As the doctor spoke, my heart raced. Yet, at the same time, I felt an unusual calm come over me. I met with the doctor while Bob sat with our daughters in the waiting room. What can I expect? What's the progression of the disease? What kind of a timeline are we talking about? I just can't say. I can give you general answers, but each person is so different, there are no definitive answers. a response that my type of personality didn't want to hear. The doctor had a question for me. How are you going to handle all of this? There I sat, a follower of Christ, somehow trying to balance the reality of all the pain Alzheimer's disease would inflict on us with the hope of God's care and eternal life in heaven. Without thinking, I responded, I guess I'm going to live on the other side of eternity. I would do my best to focus on the eternal, to trust the one who held eternity in his hands, the one who had gone ahead to prepare a place for us and would come back to take us to be with him. John chapter 14 verse 3. I had no idea how many times those words would pierce my heart and remind me where my focus had to be. When you are in the pit of caring for someone with Alzheimer's, it is a daily challenge to look beyond the pain to the hope of eternity. We walked out of the hospital different people than when we had walked in. Fog. Bob was fine, just another doctor's appointment. I told you I was fine, he laughed. But I wasn't fine. A shroud of gray, a deep fog, seemed to be rolling toward me. Slowly, it marked its path and began enveloping me. Our daughters were quiet. As we walked to the parking garage, cars whizzed by us and an ambulance careened toward the hospital, but we seemed to be walking in an alternate universe. Bob was chattering away and the sun was shining, but sounds were muffled and all I could see was gray. David was having problems crunching grades for his college students. There were other problems also, yet the doctors could not figure out what was wrong. He was seen by a neurologist and diagnosed with frontal lobe dementia. I was stunned. My father had died after a long battle with Alzheimer's. I knew this was going to be bad. Orain. That night after Bob went to bed, I cried out to the Lord. I didn't ask why. Instead, I asked how. Alzheimer's disease had become an unwelcome guest in our lives, and its presence would grow with each passing day. It felt as if we were jumping in the car and leaving on a road trip without even knowing our destination. How would I navigate this uncertain road before us? How would I make the right decisions for Bob? How could I protect his dignity and provide proper care? That fog remained my ever-present companion. I longed to wake up from this nightmare and resume my life as I knew and loved it. As I sobbed, it seemed as if God heard me and brought Abraham to my mind and heart. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him. Genesis chapter 12 verses 1-4. The Lord clearly told Abraham that he was sending him away from all that was familiar and comfortable. Abraham would leave the land, the people, and the family that he knew and loved. He would go to a place he knew nothing about, to people he didn't know. And other than his immediate family, all Abraham would have to rely on was God. I could certainly relate. Just that afternoon, I had been told that I would embark on a journey that I knew nothing about, would travel a road that was very uncertain, and would most likely have my heart broken on a daily basis. A good word. Many years before, when Bob and I were going through a crisis, a friend had shared, "There is no chaos in heaven about this." God was not then, nor is he now, sitting in heaven scratching his head asking, "How did I miss this?" For this new crisis, as for that earlier one, there was no chaos in heaven. He promised me in his word, "I shouldn't fear because he is with me," Isaiah chapter 41 verse 10. "He will never leave me or forsake me," Hebrews chapter 13 verse 5. He knew that I was scared, that I was discouraged. "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go," Joshua chapter 1 verse 9. As I thought about these verses, it became clear that I had to choose, on a daily basis, where to place my trust. Would I travel this uncertain road with the one who created the universe, who created me, and Bob, who knows the future because he has already been there? Or would I creep along in the dark, hoping to do the right thing and take the correct turns? While we were on a trip to Colorado, I became aware of my husband's confusion and forgetfulness. Upon returning home, we realized he had left his keys at security in Denver. We clung to the hope that his memory issues were due to a vitamin deficiency, but a neurologist confirmed that we were on the Alzheimer's path. Sarah. My decision was soon made. There was no choice. If the shadow of Alzheimer's has turned your world upside down, please remember that the light of God's presence and care will never dim. The next 6 months, leading to my retirement, were exceptionally difficult. I scrambled to find people who would visit with Bob for long periods of time so I could work. He had suddenly become confused, not totally, but enough that I didn't dare leave him at home alone. I was blessed with a very understanding supervisor who assured me that I could work from home as needed. But the demands of an active ministry were exhausting. Preparing a Bible study lecture each week became more draining than energizing. And having my physical body in one place while my mind and heart were in another was bankrupting my soul. Finally, the big day arrived. I exited the office and my exciting professional life to begin my new career as a full-time caregiver. And so our journey began, one fog-filled step at a time, with no knowledge of what each day would bring. 4 years passed between the day of diagnosis and Bob's death. There were days and nights, moments when I wanted to just pack it all up. Would I have chosen this path for my life? Of course not. But would I have passed up the lessons that I learned, and am still learning, the love and help from family and friends, and the deep growth in me? Absolutely not. A doctor friend wrote words that I carried in my heart throughout our journey. There's a period of time between diagnosis and the moment when a life ends, and that entire period of time contains life. Sometimes this time is months, sometimes it's years, sometimes it's weeks. Far too often we are so distracted by the perceived inevitability of death that the life contained therein passes by, and sometimes we forget to live it. In the reality of our sad, uncertain journey ahead, I decided that I would do my best to savor and celebrate the life that Bob and I would have together, in spite of, and in the presence of, Alzheimer's disease. Don't let the diagnosis and your circumstances crush you. The shadow will always be there, but there are moments of joy and memories still to be made. Look for ways to savor and celebrate. Disney World. There would be no move to a condo. We were moving to Disney World, the Alzheimer's world of fantasy and forgotten memories in which Bob would find comfort and where I would need to find some form of peace. In a way, Disney World became my slogan, a daily reminder that my life as I had planned it had come to an abrupt halt. Bob believed he was fine, so would I spend the time we had together correcting Bob's reality or going along with it? The choice to go along with it, to live in Disney World, proved to be a good one for both of us. I would do the season well, as far as it depended on me, trusting the one who would, and did, always strengthen and lead me. This is the book I never wanted to write. I had a plethora of book ideas in my head and heart for many years. Somehow, the ideas never found their way to a computer. If you are reading this book as a caregiver to a loved one with the disease, if you know someone who is a caregiver or has been diagnosed, or if you have been touched in some way by the damage done by Alzheimer's, I am writing to you. From diagnosis to my husband's death, I walked a lonely and isolated road, far different from the life I had enjoyed. Throughout our journey, though, there were people who chose to walk with us. There was also the continual assurance of God's presence and faithfulness, along with little illuminations or discoveries that would help to make this journey easier. My hope for Lingering Light is that it will offer you some light for the next step or two, that you will know you are part of a huge chorus of brothers and sisters who are on this journey, and that my story will give you strength and brighten your day. As I began to write, I realized that my story is just that, my story. In the sidebars throughout this book, you will read snippets of experiences from what I call traveling companions. Some of these are people I know personally, others are friends of friends. Each was eager to share her story with me. Traveling Light sections are nuggets of truth that I gathered throughout my journey. I learned that I had to focus on my husband and his needs, but also, I needed to care for myself. Caregivers can't be weighed down by unnecessary burdens or overly busy schedules. You can tuck these nuggets into your heart and ponder them in a spare moment. They are meant to help you focus and prepare for another step in your journey. I read short devotionals throughout Bob's illness, found lots of quotations, I love quotes, that encouraged me and gave me insight, and loved reading prayers that spoke to the struggle I was experiencing. I share them with you in the hope that they will encourage you, lighten your burden, and brighten your day, as they did for me. My journey now is a new one, learning to live as a single person. It is a challenging journey. But I believe with all my heart that nothing in life is wasted, and I pray that you will find hope in these pages, that you will see your loved one with new eyes, and that you will find strength for the days ahead. Write in this book. Share your heart. Compose your own prayer. God is listening, and His light is lingering. Traveling light. A dementia diagnosis starts you on an unexpected and unknown trajectory. But that entire period of time contains life. Plan for a demanding trip, but leave time to savor the journey. Trust the one who knows the way. A prayer to guide you. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation, and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Book of Common Prayer. 1. Kim Mareniak, The Needs of Patients and Families with Alzheimer's and Other Dementias, https://www.rn.com/clinical-insights/alzheimer-dementia/, access January 10, 2019. 2. Ken Bishop, Outliving, http://kenbishop.md/outliving/out-living, access January 10, 2019. 3. None of the men I asked were willing to share, unfortunately. I can't speak to their reasons for not responding, but men do tend to be more taciturn than women, and many men default to an "I can do this" independence that might incline them not to share their struggles as caregivers. The deep loneliness that can attend to such an approach to caregiving is an increasing area of concern in the medical community. Chapter 2: Asking for Directions. If ever there's a tomorrow when we're not together, there's something you must remember. You're braver than you believe, and stronger than you seem, and smarter than you think. Christopher Robin to Winnie the Pooh, Pooh's Grand Adventure. Most of my professional life was spent giving instructions, directions, and advice. As a teacher, I stood in front of classes of anxious students eager to learn, or at least eager to follow my direction, to earn a good grade. As a pastor, I counseled countless folks seemingly wandering in their own sea of confusion. I lectured in front of hundreds of women, helping them apply biblical truths to their lives. I was the featured speaker at retreats and conferences. People actually paid money to listen to my advice. Now I had embarked on a new journey and had no idea where I was going or how I was going to get there. And I had no advice to give myself. I was the one who had to ask for directions. Who do I ask? What do I ask? Bob remained happy and content. Nothing in his life had changed. He considered himself healthy, living in the home he loved, pruning every shrub and flowering bush in the yard, and watching his favorite TV shows. But my life had changed dramatically. Bob couldn't be left alone, so he accompanied me on every errand. He asked me the same questions over and over, and he would announce when it was time to take a walk and when it was time to eat. It didn't take me very long to realize that this arrangement was not sustainable, for me or for him. I, the direction giver, now had to be the direction receiver. I could certainly relate to King Jehoshaphat, a direction giver who was under attack by surrounding enemy armies whose sole purpose was to destroy him and his people, 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verses 1-30. It seemed as if everything surrounding me was similarly out of control, and that I was in a battle for my, and Bob's, very life. Jehoshaphat and his army were overwhelmed, outnumbered, and filled with fear. I was too. Sometimes when the heart cries out in fear, the head has to remind the heart that God is still in control and has not abandoned us. So when Jehoshaphat cried out, "We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you," 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 12, God responded, "Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you," verse 17.
Taking my cues. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.